Hello friends, today we will discuss about tools of recombinant DNA technology. So what are the things that are needed to prepare a recombinant DNA? There are three types of things. These are enzymes, vectors and hosts. There are different types of enzymes used in recombinant DNA technology. First, we will use lysing enzymes. Lysing enzymes are the enzymes that will break down the walls of bacterial cells that can be used to isolate bacterial DNA. So these are the enzymes that dissolve or break the cellular substances to take DNA out of the cell. There are different types of lysing enzymes that are used to dissolve different types of cells. For example, we have lysozyme that dissolves out the bacterial cell wall, cellulase that dissolves out the plant cell wall, and chitinase in order to isolate the DNA from fungal cells. Then we have another category of enzymes used in the formation of recombinant DNA is cleaving enzymes. These are enzymes that are used to break DNA molecules. There are three different types of cleaving enzymes. First is exonuclease. Exonuclease are the enzymes that removes nucleotide from the terminal ends of the DNA, either from the 5' end or from the 3' end. They never cleave the DNA in the central portion. They cleave the DNA only from the terminal ends only. Another category of cleaving enzymes is the endonuclease enzyme. The endonuclease enzyme cuts the DNA from random point except the terminal ends. And there is restriction endonuclease enzyme, which we used commonly in the formation of recombinant DNA, is the restriction endonuclease enzyme. These enzymes cut the DNA fragments at specific positions. There are different types of restriction endonuclease enzyme, which I will talk later. So basically, the restriction endonuclease enzyme cuts the DNA at specific position. Restriction endonuclease enzymes were discovered by Smith and Nathan in 1978. So the restriction endonuclease enzyme discovered by Nathan and Smith in 1978 are the enzymes that cuts specific DNA sequences. So these are basically called as molecular scissors, as they are used in fragmenting DNA at specific position to form recombinant DNA. The restriction in endonuclease enzymes recognize specific sequences on the DNA, which are called as the palindromes. So what are palindromes? Palindromes are the sequences which remain same as we read them from forward or backward. For example, GAATTC. When this is read from front, it is GAATTC, and in the lower portion, when it is read, it is GAATTC. So the sequences that are read from forward and backward remain same. These are called as the palindromic sequences. For example, Malayalam. These are the restriction endonuclease enzymes are also called as the molecular scissors. So what are the types of restriction endonuclease enzyme? There are three types of restriction endonuclease enzyme: type 1, type 2 and type 3 restriction endonuclease enzyme. Type 1 and type 2 restriction endonuclease enzyme cut at random positions. So we don't need these restriction endonuclease enzyme for recombinant DNA formation. We need type 2 restriction endonuclease enzyme, which cut DNA at a specific position. So here I am showing you a chart showing different types of restriction endonuclease. All these restriction endonucleases are type 2 endonucleases, and I have given the sequences of these restriction endonucleases. These restriction endonuclease cut at specific sites. For example, the EcoR1 restriction endonuclease enzyme cuts at GAATTC. It cuts between guanine and adenine. the restriction endonuclease enzyme hint third from Haemophilus influenzae cut at AAGCTT. It will cut between the two adenine residues. So these are the different types of restriction endonuclease enzymes that are used in recombinant DNA technology. These recognize different sequences along the DNA. Then, what are the nomenclature of restriction endonuclease? How the restriction endonuclease are named? So, the type 2 restriction endonuclease are named after the name of the bacterium from which they have been isolated. For example, the ECO-R1 bacterium from Escherichia coli RY13. So it has been named ECO-R1 as E for Escherichia, CO for coli, R for RY, and first because it was firstly isolated from E. coli RY13 strain. Thus it is named as ECO-R1. Then we have other category of enzymes called as synthesizing enzymes. These enzymes synthesize DNA strands. These are basically of two types. We have reverse transcriptase enzyme and DNA polymerase enzyme. Reverse transcriptase enzyme are used to synthesize DNA from mRNA. These are basically used in the formation of cDNA library. And DNA polymerase enzyme catalyzes the synthesis of DNA strand from a template strand. For example, we have a template strand, then DNA polymerase will synthesize a complementary DNA strand using nucleotides. Then we have another category of enzymes called as joining enzymes or ligases. These are also called as molecular glue. These are of two types, DNA ligase and alkaline phosphatase. DNA ligase basically seals the gaps in the DNA fragments by forming phosphodiester bond. And it is of two types, E. coli DNA ligase and T4 DNA ligase. So here I am showing you the difference between E. coli DNA ligase and T4 DNA ligase. E. coli DNA ligase can ligate DNA and DNA. It cannot ligate blunt ends. It ligates sticky ends. However, the T4 DNA ligase obtained from T4 bacteriophage ligates DNA and DNA. It can ligate DNA and RNA. It can ligate blunt end as well as it can ligate sticky ends also. So we can prefer T4 DNA ligase more in comparison to the E. coli DNA ligase. So we were talking about the ligase and I have told you about the difference between E. coli DNA ligase and T4 DNA ligase. E. coli DNA ligase cannot ligate blunt ends. However, the T4 DNA ligase can ligate the blunt ends. Another category of joining enzymes include alkaline phosphatase. It removes the phosphate group from the terminal 5' end of the double or single stranded DNA and RNA. Hence, it is also used as a joining enzyme. After the removal of phosphate group from the 5' end, it helps in the formation of phosphodiester bond. Thus, in this way, it acts as a joining enzyme. Then we have second tool for the formation of recombinant DNA, which are the vectors. Vectors are those substances that carry our foreign DNA and replicate inside the host cell. We can use different types of vectors in recombinant DNA technology. For example, we can use plasmid. Plasmids are self-replicating circular DNA in E. coli. In E. coli bacteria, plasmids are present in spite of its main genome. These are the structures that are self-replicating in nature. So these are used as vectors for the formation of recombinant DNA. Besides that, we can use bacteriophage. Bacteriophages are the virus that infect bacteria, so that we can introduce our genes into the bacteriophages that infect bacteria and multiply our desired gene into many copies. Then we can use cosmids as vector, which includes the cause sites of the bacteriophage lambda and a plasmid. It can encode 45 kilobases of the DNA sequences. Then we can have phagemids as vector, which involves plasmid and bacteriophage. Then we can have virus vectors. Viral vectors, we can use a virus as a vector so that we can clone our DNA. Then, what are the characters of the vectors? Basically, our vector consists of three different portions. First, we have origin of replication. Origin of replication are those points on the plasmid or on the vectors from which replication start. If we insert our gene near to the origin of replication, then our gene will replicate faster. Then we can have a selectable marker, which is used to identify transformed cell. Selectable marker includes genes for different types of resistances, as it can include genes for antibiotic resistance, as ampicillin resistance. It can include tetracycline resistant gene, a herbicide gene, or a kanamycin resistant gene. It will depend upon the type of plasmid used. So what are the transformed cells? Transformed cells are the cells that have recombinant DNA, and our plasmid will have recognition sites or cloning sites. These are the sites that are cutted by the restriction endonuclease enzyme so that our foreign DNA can be inserted. So the plasmid will have origin of replication from which replication starts. It has a selectable marker which contains the genes for resistant of an antibiotic, through which we can do screening or selection. And it has a multi-cloning site where different types of restriction endonuclease enzyme can act and cleave the plasmid so that our gene can be inserted in that portion. Then I will talk about the third tool for recombinant DNA formation, is the plasmid. Plasmids are extrachromosomal self-replicating circular double-stranded DNA found in bacteria. As in this diagram, you can see clearly the plasmid, which is separate from the main genome of bacteria. It is single, circular double-stranded DNA self-replicating in nature. And I will discuss about the types of plasmid used in recombinant DNA technology. So, the plasmids were discovered by William Hay and Lederberg in 1952. Examples of plasmid used in recombinant DNA technology. First one is PBR322 vector. PBR322 has given its name from P for plasmid, B for Bolivar, and R for Rodriguez. These are the name of the scientist who had made this plasmid vector. So, the special characteristics of the PBR322 vector is that it consists of origin of replication, it consists of ampicillin resistant gene, it consists of a tetracycline resistant gene, as well as it consists of a restriction site, which you can see in this diagram. Then we will have a second category of plasmid commonly used as a vector in recombinant DNA technology, is the PUC vector. It has given its name from Plasmid University, California, because it has been constructed in the University of California. So what are the specialist features of this plasmid is that it consists of an ampicillin resistant gene, it consists of an origin of replication has been taken from PBR322, and it consists of lag Z gene fragment. So this type of vector can be clearly used in blue-white screening to identify that our gene contains an insert or not. So we have discussed about the recombinant DNA tools. Then I will explain you how a recombinant plasmid is made. We have taken a foreign DNA which contains our desired gene that is isolated by using different types of lysing and cleaving enzymes, and we have a plasmid which has been isolated by using lysing enzymes and centrifugation techniques. Then we will treat our plasmid as well as our foreign DNA with restriction endonuclease. We will get sticky ends through which we can combine our desired gene with the plasmid vector. So how will we can do this? We can do this by means of DNA ligase, which is commonly called as molecular glue. In this diagram, you can see that how the DNA ligase combines the desired gene as well as our plasmid vector into a recombinant plasmid. Our recombinant plasmid contains the desired gene. This desired gene and recombinant plasmid has been introduced into the bacteria like E. coli. So the bacteria may take up the plasmid with or without an insert. It is not necessary that our plasmid will combine with the desired gene. It can self-ligate also. And it is not also necessary that our bacteria will take up the recombinant DNA. So, in order to find out that our recombinant DNA has inserted into the E. coli, we will perform a selection test or screening test. You can see about the selection or screening test in my next video. So, thank you so much. That's about today. Thank you.